Alright guys, we're back staring at my engine bay, and in this video we're going to try to figure out what's wrong with my 340i. And so hopefully this video can help you guys out if maybe you're running into misfires or having any issues with your car breaking up. Maybe it's just having a rough idle or whatever your problem might be. This will kind of help show you what potentially could be the problem and help guide you through how I would try to diagnose a misfire. And this can be kind of difficult because a misfire can be caused by so many different things. So normally when I'm trying to diagnose a misfire, I start with things that are easy to identify, easier to diagnose, and easy to repair. And if that doesn't work, then you can start kind of going down the rabbit hole into things that are more difficult to diagnose or repair. And hopefully that process will help you identify your issue. So to start things off, we'll talk about the history on my 340i. This is a car that I bought from Copart. And I was looking there to buy a car just because I was hoping I could get something a little bit cheaper. Maybe it had a little bit of body damage or a salvage rebuilt title, whatever, in order to make it a little bit easier to buy. Now this one attracted me because it's actually clean title, no body damage, good condition. It was just listed with mechanical issues. So as a part of this, I was basically just trying to identify any history I could find on the car. And it turned out that the previous owner was following me on Instagram. And I posted up a little bit of information while I was in the process of buying it. He realized from what I said that it was his car, and he was able to basically send me a message. So I was able to look through our chat history, and he actually was somebody that I was trying to help fix this car in the past, which is kind of crazy. So I could see in our chat history all of the problems that he had and what he had done to try to fix it. And long story short, when he got this car, it was already smoking a little bit, and they identified that the turbo was basically bad. So they replaced the turbo, upgraded the fuel pump, and did a couple other modifications, and he was good to go for a little while. But eventually it started misfiring again, and he was running into a lot of different issues. I remember at one point he was having an issue with the throttle body, and he found that there was like a loose gasket in the charge pipe that got stuck in it and prevented it from working properly. And again, he fixed that, but eventually it started misfiring and smoking again. So through that process, I tried helping him a lot, but eventually he dropped it off at the dealership. And after their diagnosis, they basically determined that they had spent too much time and money on the car trying to replace things. They replaced the injectors, the fuel pump, and the spark plugs, and probably other stuff. And at that time, they kind of just said it's time to cut their losses and replace the whole engine. So that's when he decided to drop it off at Copart and have them sell it for him. Knowing that the car was hurt, he felt like that was the easiest and best way to sell it with clear transparency that the car wasn't in perfect condition. Now, I'm still a little bit optimistic that it's not as catastrophic as the dealer thought, but what's funny is after I posted my last video showing that I bought it, somebody saw the video and sent me a message, and it was the previous owner. And so he was able to send me a lot of videos showing that the car used to run very well, and he had a lot of time and experience with it because at some point he installed nitrous on the car. So the car was stock turbo running an ethanol mix, but he also put a small shot on top of that to help to just push the car and give it a little bit more of an edge. So it's kind of funny hearing that now because it is what it is. I've already got it and who knows what happened, but I do know that he did a lot of work fixing it. He did things like he broke the drive shaft, so he replaced that, the fuel tank, and other parts in the rear end. But yeah, I mean, he drove the car very hard, raced it a lot, and eventually, you know, it was just time for him to get rid of it and move into a faster platform. So now it's mine, and I feel like a dealer because hearing all the problems that he had and everything that was happening before it got to me gives me a good idea of what could be wrong with it. But when I got the car, it's perfectly fine. And you know how it is with the dealer, like you're having all these problems and you drop it off with them and they just can't seem to replicate the issue. But knowing how much of an issue he had, I decided I'm not going to drive it or push it really hard. I'm simply just going to try to diagnose it, even though it's not misfiring or smoking for me. Now, there are a lot of different things that we can look at to try to get this going. So the first thing that I like to do is just pop the hood and look around to see if there's anything obvious. And when I got the car, that was the first thing I did. They took it off of the trailer and I basically popped the hood, took off the engine cover and just looked around. And of course, a couple things jumped out at me immediately. The charge pipe sensors were completely unplugged. I have no idea why. Somebody must have been messing with it. And even you can see that one of the screws are different from the OEM one. So at some point they took this off, I guess lost a screw, one or two screws, and replaced it with what they had. So I'll be in the process of returning this back to stock, but that was obviously something that would cause an issue. So I reached out to the previous owner and he was obviously like, no way. If that was disconnected, that's something that the dealership would have found or would have caused a lot of other issues. So I think they were just kind of messing with it at the junkyard. Then the other thing that I found was that this evap hose on the intake was disconnected. And of course that could cause a misfire as well. And that's something that's really easy to look for sometimes. If you think that you have a boost leak or a vacuum leak, anything that is leaking air after the MAF sensor can cause a misfire and a rough idle, because the MAF sensor is trying to calculate how much air is coming into the engine. And if there are any leaks or anything that disrupt how much air actually gets into the combustion chamber, it's going to make the car run like crap. A really simple and easy way to check that is just to unplug the MAF and drive it around. And if your idle smooths out and the car drives fine, then there's most likely either a MAF sensor issue or an issue somewhere along the intake and charge piping that's causing you to lose boost. Now, fortunately, in my case, I realized that the evap hose coming off didn't matter too much because the whole entire intake is falling off of the turbo. So I'm going to be replacing all of this silicone down here with the OEM turbo inlet, OEM intake, and OEM charge pipe just to kind of get it back to stock and give myself a good baseline to start with. Now, issues like that will typically cause random misfires because air leakage or sensors not working properly will not kind of prioritize any specific cylinder. Whereas sometimes if you're having a specific cylinder issue, that will show up in your codes. So the next step that I recommend if you're not seeing anything jump out at you yet is to go ahead and scan for codes. I like using ISTA. If you have it, I highly recommend it because it gives you a lot of information as well as even historical codes that might not be currently active, but you can see previous issues that have happened to the car, and that might give you a little bit more information on what happened leading up to your current problem. You can also use your tuning software. Boot Mode, MHD, and MG Flasher all offer the capability to scan for codes and run diagnostics. So definitely do that, and that will tell you if there's a specific cylinder having a misfire or if it's a random misfire that could be caused by something else. Now, unfortunately, in my case, it looks like the codes were cleared right before they sold the car. Literally nothing is showing up in the codes except for the immediate issues that I identified. So you can see there's the open circuit one for my intake air temp sensor and the pressure sensor, which I plugged back in. So I went ahead and cleared those codes. I'm still not going to drive the car, but I just know that the information in there isn't really telling me what I need. Luckily, in my case, I do have the previous owner in my DM, so he was telling me that it's specifically a cylinder 6 issue, and I am going to start diagnosing it as such. So when you have a specific cylinder misfiring, the first thing that you want to do is swap around spark plugs and coil packs. So in my case, since it's cylinder 6, what I can do is move the spark plug to cylinder 5 and the coil pack to cylinder 4 and just swap them around and then start the car and drive it around. If I see that the misfire moves to cylinder 5, then I know it's a spark plug issue. If I see it move to cylinder 4, I know it's a coil pack issue. And then that's a really easy way to quickly diagnose where the problem is and replace that individual component. Now, 9 times out of 10, if this is the problem, it's going to be the spark plugs. The coil packs on our cars last a really long time and work really well, so I haven't seen very many coil pack failures, but it is definitely a possibility. If you do have a failure, it's not going to hurt you to replace all 6, because 9 times out of 10, they're just kind of reaching the end of their life, and it's time to replace them. Now, in my case, I know that's not the specific problem, so I'm going to go ahead and start digging into it deeper and jump right into doing a compression check. All right, guys, sorry to just jump ahead like this, but obviously I've done a lot of work to the car, and after filming everything, I realized the video was really, really long. So I'm going to split this up into a part 1 and part 2. So this video should be able to help you out if you have like a more simple, less complex issue causing your misfire. But eventually I did a compression test and a leak down test and really dug into it. So I will also make a separate DIY video for that in the next couple days. So yeah, hopefully this helps you out, and hopefully that's as far as you needed to go to figure out what was causing your misfire. Thank you guys all for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do